Buck Lane. So Buck Lane is a physical phenomenon of transgender members being bent horizontally from their longitudinal position due to compression, which you can kind of tell in the diagram here that it's bent laterally, probably from the support. Some images on where columns have buckled. So there's two different types of buckling. The bifurcation type of buckling, which is entirely conceptual. If it occurs in a perfectly straight and homogeneous member, subjected to a compressive force in which the result is passed through the centroidal axis of the member. But the deflection amplification type of buckling is the column buckling, as engineers have witnessed in real-world applications. Both types don't take place as a result of resisting stress, reaching a limit strength of the material. The stress at which buckling occurs depends on a variety of factors ranging from the dimensions of the member to the boundary conditions to the properties of the material of the member. So first, I'm just going to introduce the Euler column, which is the ideal model. The assumptions given for that is that the member is prismatic, it's pinned at both ends, however the top end can translate vertically, and the member is of course straight with a load of P, considered to be concentric and positive when it causes compression. The material obeys Hooke's law, and the deformations of the member are small, and that the term derivative of y squared is negligible compared to the unity in the expression for the curvature in this equation. Thus, the curvature can be approximated by the second derivative of y, y double prime. This is the model in the free body diagram for that, and this is where we get a second order linear differential equation based on this free body diagram. P versus Y and stress or strain diagrams, and in my report I show where the eigenpair comes from. We have our critical load it can withstand and eigenvector. So elastic buckling of columns is when a column is subjected to distributed compressive forces along its plane. Governing differential equation of the deflected curve, it is no longer a differential equation with constant coefficients as with this equation in the Euler column. The solution to this problem may be considered in three different ways. One is the application of the series, such as Bessel functions. One of the energy methods, such as the energy method, and the finite element. Here's an example of elastic buckling columns with a cantilever column with a distributed load, and we get this equation right here. The integral on the right hand side of the equation denotes the bending moment at any point in the cross section created by the distributed load. So in and out of each buckling of columns. So the elastic analysis doesn't work for short columns. So the limiting load must be determined by taking inelastic behavior into consideration. Finite elements are capable of conducting incremental analyses of the geometric and material nonlinear variables. Can't say that word. And correctly evaluate the inelastic column strengths, as well as the effects of initial deficiencies, inelastic material properties, comprising of strain hardening and residual stress. So the method I use in my report is one of two methods, is the double modulus theory. Double modulus theory for elastic buckling has these assumptions. Small displacement theory still stands, plane sections remain plane. The correlation of stress and strain in longitudinal fibers is given by the stress-strain diagram of the material. Column section is seemingly symmetric, and axial load continues to stay constant. So this is a reduced modulus model, which shows how these derivations of the equations in over P delta diagram or stress strain, etc. So here's kind of some rhythm deriving of the equations where we have the small displacement theory still stands as one of the assumptions. So displacement theory still stands. Similar triangles in this diagram to get our different strains and stresses. And we have E sub T is our tangent modulus. S1 is tension, S2 is compression. Continuing on, pure bending portion is given by this equation, and equating the internal moment of the external moment yields this equation. This equation here gets expanded to this differential equation. This migration equation. And this is expanded to this equation. That all basically leads to where we have our key critical. I know that's kind of hard to see. Looks a lot like the other equation, but we do have our reduced modulus, which is given by this equation here. And of course, our critical stress, which is similar, but a little bit different. L by R. And introducing the stress given the reduced modulus over the modulus of elasticity, let's say 1. Differential equation would then be EI shear stress Y over I plus EY equals 0. And we're left with this equation here, which is P critical over area. So it kind of shows where we get this. And there's a procedure for determining our critical stress, which I summarized with these three points. Again, we have our stress strain diagram here, unloading E governs, loading tangent modulus governs. There's critical shear stress, critical stress, and P equals P critical here. Is there any questions regarding all these equations that I've shown you, or any part of this?